The end of the year exams approached and Lily immediately shushed the inane chattering coming from the 10 supernaturals behind her, waving her arms like a crazy person as her emerald orbs lit up with curiosity. "Shush. I want to see how well my baby does in her exams." "Well, Elena hesitantly spoke up, not wanting to upset the dead mother. Although she was a vampire, Lily Potter could be downright terrifying. "Neville is the only one taking the exam seriously. I mean, Venus and Alex didn't even open a book or anything." Lily snorted, but smiled fondly, lost in a faraway memory. James and Sirius were the same. It was a rare sight to see them studying, but they still aced their exams and were one of the top 5 in our year. I believe Venus inherited the same miraculous ability, also known as laziness. Alex groaned loudly and rested her head on Venus's shoulder after McGonagall's speech. "How am I supposed to cheat with those anti-cheating spells? No fair. I thought Justin was kidding when he told me about them." Trading an amused glance with Venus, Neville chuckled, "Get used to it, Alex. Fred and George tried every loophole with no success." "Just like their uncles." Lily shook her head with a soft smile. Jeremy gaped in surprise. "Anti-cheating spell really works?" Lily nodded softly. "Oh yeah. There's always an arrogant sod that doesn't believe McGonagall and tries to cheat every year." The 10 supernaturals and a hyper Lily observed as Venus successfully passed her practical charms exams. She had her pineapple tap dance and then finished it off with a few impressive gymnastic twirls, much to Flitwick's enthusiasm, and he crowed with tumultuous praise as he compared her to Lily. For the transfiguration practical, Venus effortlessly turned a mouse into a snuffbox, going as far as to decorate it with Gryffindor colors and an elaborate lion. McGonagall blinked away the tears and congratulated her before comparing her to James Potter. "She really is a natural," Elijah beamed with pride at his niece. The 10 supernaturals, however, were in collective awe over the spellwork, and Carolyn, who was adverse to rats and mice, breathed out a sigh of relief once the ugly pest was transformed into a beautiful snuffbox. But during the potions exam, Lily pursed her lips into a thin line with her arms crossed, not bothering to utter a word in defense to her ex-friend. Cole, on the other hand, had no problem commenting. "A forgetfulness potion while the greasy bastard breathes down their necks. How ironic. I hate that guy." "What I want to know," everyone simultaneously turned to Klaus, who hadn't said a word since the exam period began, until now, "why on earth is her scar so inflamed?" The acuity blue-green orbs of the original hybrid had been scrutinizing the girl, and unlike the other spectators, he didn't fail to notice how Venus incessantly rubbed her scar, and how the curious lightning bolt started swelling, turning to an angry red color. Immediately, the 9 other supernaturals and Lily snapped their gaze toward the honey blonde girl who was currently sitting by the lake with Alex and Neville, their keen orbs widening upon noticing for the very first time the inflamed scar. Noticing all the attention solely fixed on her, Lily blustered for a moment, I don't know. Despite me being dead, I haven't been told everything yet. Since I was elected to be your guide, the higher-uppers in the other side decided it was best I don't know everything." "V, maybe you should go see Madame Pomfrey," Neville suggested timidly as he scooched closer to her side, his warm hazel orbs examining the angry scar on her forehead. Hearing the worry in Neville's voice, Alex glanced at her best female friend before her eyes widened in horror. "Holy crap. How did I not notice it before? Come on, V, up you get. To the hospital wing we go." Venus quickly shook her head and pulled Alex back onto the grass beside her. "I'm not ill. Besides, if that dragon lady ensnares me in her clutches, I'll never escape that room of horrors." Despite the situation, Alex and Neville sniggered. Ever since the first Quidditch match against Slytherin, Venus had made her loathing of the hospital wing clear to all. "Hospitals aren't that bad," Damon smirked, his mind immediately drifting off to the large collection of blood bags he constantly pilfered during his stay in Mystic Falls in order to keep up the Good Samaritan act. Elena scoffed, glaring at her boyfriend knowingly. "No, seriously. My dad was a doctor. Hospitals aren't that bad. Once you're under Poppy Pomfrey's care, you'll all think otherwise. That woman is a mother hen and a worrywart combined into one stick of a figure. Even if you have the flu, she'll keep you under her watch for hours or days if she could get away with it, Lily explained. Hesitantly, Rebecca asked, What about you? Did you visit her a lot? Oh, Merlin, no, Lily tittered before a fond smile broke out on her gorgeous face, no. That was more up James, Sirius and Rima Sally. Oh, how they tried avoiding Poppy, to no avail, what with the amount of times their pranks backfired or they got into duels with the Slytherins. The 10 Supernaturals felt bad for the dead mother as she sadly recalled the good days of her youth. Clearing his throat, Stefan said, Who's Remus? They all looked at Lily in curiosity. They already knew James, and in the memories of the past, they witnessed Sirius and Neville's parents, Frank and Alice, but Remus was new to them. Lily beamed. Remus was another marauder. James and Sirius' best friend. I'm sure you'll hear about him later. Ignoring her aversion to the hospital wing, Alex spoke up once she was done laughing. You can't go on like this. It's a wonder you managed to attend all your exams. Venus' nose scrunched up in thought and she once again rubbed her scar. I think it's a warning, it means danger's coming. Neville's brows knitted together in concern. Venus, relax. Don't get worked up over the stone. It's safe as long as Dumbledore's around. Alex nodded enthusiastically, mirth gleaming in her chocolate orbs. Besides, Neville will play Quidditch for England before Hagrid lets Dumbledore down. Hey! Neville swatted her head in mock offense. Venus, however, turned ashen, her emeralds widening in horror, and she abruptly stood up and darted over to Hagrid's hut, ignoring Neville and Alex's yelling to wait up. Cole grinned, why do I have a bad feeling about this? Klaus, Rebecca and Elijah knew that their laid-back, mischievous and nonchalant brother was masking his concern with that annoying patent grin of his. Catching up with the honey blonde, Alex clutched the stitch in her chest and panted, What's with the face, V? Don't you think it's a bit off that what Hagrid wants more than anything in the world is a dragon, and a stranger turns up who just happens to have an egg in his pocket? It's not exactly a smart thing to do if it's against the law. Not to forget, this stranger miraculously meets somebody who desperately wants a dragon. Coincidence? I think not. Venus rambled as they neared Hagrid's hut. Alex gaped in shock while Neville blanched. Hagrid! Lily shrieked, her face blending with her vibrant red hair. You don't think the person with the egg is the person after the stone, do you? Bonnie asked fearfully. Caroline harumphed, forget that, Bonnie. I think the correct question is, do you think Hagrid blabbed? Surprisingly, an enraged Lily snarled, oh, he fessed up all right. Instead of inquiring the incensed redhead, the 10 Supernaturals listened with abated breath, as the Troubles threesome interrogated a bemused Hagrid. Did he, play 20 questions with you about Fluffy? Alex jested lightly in hopes of calming her rapidly beating heart. Well, yeah, how many three-headed dogs do you meet, even around Hogwarts? Hagrid looked proud of his accomplishment, failing to notice the identical looks of mounting horror on the Troubles threesome's face, so I told him, Fluffy's a piece of cake if you know how to calm him down, just play him a bit of music and he'll go straight off to sleep. Hagrid. The 10 Supernaturals and Lily yelled out. Shit just hit the fan, Damon commented in a matter-of-fact tone. The scene then played forward in a quick pace. They observed the Troubles threesome begin searching for Dumbledore's office. You know, with the amount of trouble we got into this year, I cannot believe we haven't been sent to the headmaster's office yet, Venus groaned in disappointment, regardless of the ominous situation they were in the middle of. Alex nodded in wholehearted agreement, sharing Venus' horror, that will be our new goal for next year. How about you two be quiet about breaking the rules for a minute? Let's ask Fred and George, Neville snapped, his plump face twisting in consternation. At least somebody is thinking straight. I swear, Venus and Alex are little terrors, all right. James and Sirius would be over the moon, Lily grumbled in irritation. But just as Neville suggested the Weasley twins, Professor McGonagall ambled by them, Lily only managed to let out a sigh of relief for a sheer minute before she began raging again due to Minerva's fervent disbelief. The scene jumped, and the 10 supernaturals and Lily found themselves in the Gryffindor common room. The Troubles threesome were congregated in an isolated part of the room, away from their mingling housemates who were all celebrating over the end of examinations. Well, that's it then, isn't it? Venus spoke up. For once, all mirth and mischief evaporated from Alex's mien as she stared at her determined best friend, and Neville was trembling slightly in comprehension. I'm going out of here tonight and I'm going to try and get to the stone first. Venus Jamie Potter. Don't you dare. Lily yelled hysterically at the top of her lungs, tears mingling with her red face. She's mad. Damon and Cole snapped, and for once, they didn't bother glaring at each other for uttering the same words, both of them too wrapped up in the solemn situation they were forced to witness. Klaus clenched and unclenched his fists, stubbornly keeping his mouth shut, his blue-green orbs concentrating on Alex and Neville instead of his dad, instead of Venus. Having memorized their brother's indifferent facade by heart over the centuries, Elijah and Rebecca stayed close to his person for silent support. V. Alex weakly choked out. This isn't something we can chalk up as a cool adventure, excited over breaking the rules, this is serious shit. I know. Venus snapped, her emerald orbs blazing with fierce tenacity. This isn't a game to me. Don't you understand? If Snape gets hold of the stone, Voldemort's coming back. Haven't you heard what it was like when he was trying to take over? He'll flatten this school or turn it into a school for the dark arts. He killed my parents. I'm an orphan because of him and forced to live with horrible relatives. I lived a decade of hell. And if he comes back, do you honestly think he'll leave you and your families alone? Even if I don't go and stop him, it's only dying a bit later because I'm never going to the dark side. I'm going through that trapdoor tonight and nothing you two say is going to stop me. Lily began crying during Venus' emotional diatribe along with Rebecca, Elena, Bonnie, and Carolyn. Klaus adamantly kept his eyes fixated on the opposite wall, his nails digging into his palms, and he didn't even notice that Cole and Elijah placed a comforting hand on each of his shoulder. Neville squared his shoulders and nodded. I'm in. V. Volume Voldemort is the reason why my parents are at St. Mungo's. I'm with you, V. What happened to Frank and Alice? Elena asked through her sobs. But Lily shook her head in confusion. They didn't tell me that either. I don't know. Ah, what the hell? Let's kick some dark douche's ass. Alex smiled grimly, trying to infuse a bit of humor into their morbid situation. The 10 supernaturals and Lily watched the Troubles threesome like a hawk, their eyes never once wavering from them as they donned on the invisibility cloak and followed them to the third floor corridor. They only had a slight run-in with Peeves, but in a bout of brilliancy, Venus imitated the Bloody Baron and successfully banished the irritating poltergeist from their path. Seeing the three-headed dog in the flesh didn't bode well, and the 10 supernaturals gaped at the monstrous creature, their eyes flickering in defeat toward the golden harp that lay by their massive feet. The second the trio shut the door behind them, three pairs of eyes began to flutter open, and Alex wasted no time in waving her wand toward the harp, breathing a sigh of relief when the soft melodious music permeated the cramped space and the yellow orbs once again snapped shut. Neville gaped at the raven head in awe. How did you know to do that? Shrugging nonchalantly, Alex said, my dad taught my brothers and I a few spells before Hogwarts. Disregarding the conversation, Venus made a beeline toward the trapdoor and, after pushing away a massive feat, opened the latch and swung the floorboard open. All I see is black down there. I'm going to go first. See ye on the other side. You don't just jump into the unknown without a thought. You had to inherit serious rashness, did you? Lily growled, slapping a hand to her forehead in fear. Once Neville and Alex joined the honey blonde through the trapdoor, the 10 supernaturals' eyes widened in horror. The plant they landed on had started to twist snake-like tendrils around Venus and Alex's ankles, while Neville had been lucky enough to jump out of the way. His hazel orbs lit up in recognition. "Stop moving, you two. This is Devil's Snare." Neville, ever the herbology whiz, hurriedly informed them. Alex glared at him, but it lacked any heat as a tendril began to curl around her neck. "Great job, Nev. 20 points to Gryffindor. Now put your aptitude for herbology to good use and stop this damn plant from throttling us to death." Her voice rose hysterically toward the end. "Fire. Come on, Neville. Devil's Snare hates sunlight. You can do it," Lily worriedly shouted out. "What the hell is the purpose of this Devil's Snare?" Cole snapped angrily, worried over his niece's life. "Unlike them, those three kids won't be able to resuscitate from suffocation or having their necks snapped." Sneaking a glance at his brother, Cole grimaced at the enraged emotion mixed with palpable concern radiating from Klaus' stoic visage. "Shut up, Alex. Let Neville concentrate," Venus yelled just as a tendril wrapped around her mouth, muffling her next words. Neville's eyes narrowed in concentration, his hand gripping his wand firmly, and he waved it, lumos solemn. A bright, narrow beam of light infiltrated the room, prompting the Devil's Snare to shriek out in pain and cringe backwards, retreating from Venus and Alex. "Thank God for Neville," Caroline breathed out in relief, looping arms with Elena and Bonnie. Klaus finally calmed down as he watched Venus catch a key to get to the other side. Thankful that her life wasn't in danger with this specific test, that was until his blue-green orbs landed on the giant chess set. Lily groaned, "You have got to be kidding me." "Oh, Minerva, it had to be a live chessboard. What's so bad about it? I mean, they play the game and if they win, they go on ahead to the other side," Jeremy shrugged. But Lily rapidly shook her head, wringing her wrists in worry. "No, no, Jeremy, you are forgetting that this is wizard's chess, which means the chessmen will move, remember?" 10 sets of faces paled rapidly at the insinuation, recalling the Christmas holidays when Alex and Venus engaged in a game of chess with the Weasleys and of how aggressive the game was in comparison to mundane chess. "Damn. If only Justin were here. He's a nerd when it comes to chess," Alex moaned, slumping onto the ground in defeat. "I never had the patience for the stupid game, and I hated thinking strategy." Venus' cheeks puffed out in defeat, her emerald orbs beseeching Neville, "Please tell me you're good at chess." Neville chuckled nervously and tentatively approached the Black Knight. "Well, I'm no Ron, but my great uncle Elgi taught me a few tricks. Let's hope for good luck then. What do we do, Nev?" Venus silently placed Neville in charge and kept her hand linked tightly with Alex's. 20 minutes passed by, and the 10 supernaturals and Lily were in a state of agitation, 11 pairs of eyes attached onto Neville's determined yet worried form as he sat on the knight and barked out orders to the chessmen. The 10 supernaturals' first real shock came when the White Queen smashed their Black Knight to the floor and dragged it off the board in shattered pieces. Twice, Neville managed to save Venus and Alex in the nick of time while darting around the board, taking as many white pieces as they lost black ones. And finally, Venus moved 3 spaces to the left. "Checkmate," she stated in relief. The White King took her off his crown and threw it at her feet. Alex began jumping on her feet, squealing, "We won, we won. Neff, you are brilliant. You saved our necks twice now." With a bashful smile, Neville joined the 2 girls and the Troubles' threes opened the other door, their eyes widening at the injured troll who reeked of putrid flesh and dirty socks. Although it had a bloody lump on its head, the troll had enough energy to charge over to them with its club raised. "So, we miss out the troll on Halloween only to confront another one at the end of the year? Gotta love the irony," Venus snarled as she danced around the troll's disgusting feet. Together, Venus and Alex yelled, "Reducto," repeatedly. "Why isn't the spell working?" Klaus snarled, foregoing all apathy and allowing his worry to show. With her hands clasped over her mouth, Lily's muffled voice permeated around them. Their skin is mostly spell-proof, trolls have a thick layer of skin, it will take powerful magic to knock one out. Having had enough with dancing around the troll, Venus swished, flicked and randomly yelled, Wingardium Leviosa. Three pairs of orbs watched in awe as the club levitated over the confused troll's head, and dropped down, forming another bump on its head and collapsing on the ground with an audible thump, the floor shaking beneath their feet. Huh, why didn't we think of that before? Alex grinned, her tiny foot nudging the head of the unconscious troll. Neville let out a loud sigh and weakly smiled, good job, V. Let's get out of here. Snape. Alex groaned upon walking over the threshold and seeing a table with seven differently shaped bottles standing on a line. I bet you they're all poison, Damon snarkily commented. I cannot believe I'm saying this. But I agree with Damon, Cole forcibly grumbled. The ten supernaturals and Lily observed as Venus seized a roll of paper lying next to the bottles and read the riddle out loud. Danger lies before you, while safety lies behind, two of us will help you, whichever you would find, one of us seven will let you move ahead, another will transport the drinker back instead, two among our number hold only nettle wine, three of us are killers, waiting hidden in line, choose, unless you wish to stay here forevermore. To help you in your choice, we give you these clues for, first, however slyly the poison tries to hide, you will always find some on nettle wine's left side, second, different are those who stand at either end, but if you would move onward, neither is your friend, third, as you see clearly, all are different size, neither dwarf nor giant holds death in their insides, fourth, the second left and the second on the right, are twins once you taste them. Though different at first sight. What the? I didn't understand anything. Caroline huffed, her blonde head swiveling around to stare at the other confused supernaturals. Did you guys get it? While most of them shook their head in negative, Klaus and Elijah nodded in affirmative. If I am able to read it over, I believe I could solve the logic puzzle. Elijah smiled at the flabbergasted looks of awe him and Klaus were on the receiving end of. Klaus shrugged indifferently, his eyes concentrating on Venus as she reread the riddle. We're over 1,000 years old, it wouldn't be hard to crack the case. Besides, there were obvious clues in the riddle. I never had the patience for such puzzles, Cole blanched at the thought of thinking over that damn riddle his niece was currently decrypting. Lily smiled despite the perilous situation. That's why Severus' protection was nifty. Most wizards and witches are arrogant, placing all their strength on their ability to use magic. They barely have any ounce of logic and would be stuck in the forever. Did you solve it yet? This is more your forte, V, Alex called out. Her and Neville have been sitting on the ground watching Venus mumble incessantly under her breath for the better half of 5 minutes. Clapping her hands together, the honey blonde witch smiled grimly, got it. The smallest bottle will get us through the black fire, toward the stone. The problem is, there's only enough for one of us. That's hardly one swallow, she said, displaying the bottle for Alex and Neville to see. No. If your friends are unable to come with you, then you turn right back and leave it for the adults to handle, Lily snapped with authority. Jeremy grimaced, while I agree with you, Dumbledore left the castle, that means the person who was trying all year to steal the stone, is probably already in the other side. That doesn't mean she has to play the hero. Klaus growled, worried beyond belief. Oh how he hated and loved that little girl, love was making him weak. He knew that Elijah and Rebecca believed differently, believing love made them stronger, but throughout the millennium, Klaus never allowed his many enemies to uncover a weakness. His siblings were immortal, originals and powerful. They could never get overpowered or used against him. Venus on the other hand. Alex frowned in puzzlement, we know because of the harp by Fluffy's feet that Snape already made it to the other side. That means the bottle would fill up by itself. You genius. Lily cheered, feeling her worry abate slightly now that there was a possibility her baby wouldn't be moving forward on her own. Exactly, Neville's plump face was resolved, or we can just duplicate them and go in together in case it takes a while to get refilled. With their conundrum settled, Alex pointed her wand at the bottle in Venus' hand, and casted, Gemino, twice. Bottoms up. Venus nervously smiled, raising her bottle in the air. Alex copied Venus and clinked her bottle with the other two, cheers. Once they imbibed the potion, they all winced and shivered at the icy feeling running through their veins, and they linked hands, braced themselves and resolutely walked through the black fire. What? The 11 spectators barked out in palpable surprise. Standing on the other side in front of the mirror of Erised, was not the greasy-haired Snape, but the stuttering fool, Quirrell, staring at the troubles threesome with a smug smile that leaked of arrogance. You! Venus gasped, her hands tightening over a befuddled Neville and gaping Alex. Me, he said calmly. I wondered whether I'd be meeting you here, Potter. Though, Russo and Longbottom were unexpected. Hey! What happened to your annoying stutter? Alex snapped, glaring at Quirrell with palpable irritation. I don't blame her. That stutter was aggravating, Cole sneered, his mahogany orbs turning murky red as he glared maliciously at Quirrell. Aye, boo, but, what about Snape? Quirrell's cold, sharp laugh interrupted the rest of Neville's question, Severus? Yes, Severus does seem the type, doesn't he? So useful to have him swooping around like an overgrown bat. Next to him, who would suspect poor, st stuttering P. Professor Quirrell? Venus couldn't take it in any longer. Do you know how annoying that quivering treble was? It was suicide listening to your damn voice day in and day out. You could have remained evil without stuttering like an incompetent fool. Lily groaned, damn your bravery, Venus. Damn it. That mouth of hers will get her into a lot of trouble in the future, Stefan grimaced, staring at Klaus with pity, not that the original hybrid noticed. For his face was twisted in rage, glaring daggers into the back of that damn lurid turban and inwardly promising retribution. Never mind that. Snape tried to kill her at the Quidditch game. Neville bellowed. It seems his job would be to snap Venus and Alex and point them directly toward the main problem at hand, since they found themselves drifting off to unimportant matters on a daily basis. No, no, no. I tried to kill her. And I would have succeeded if it weren't for you, Miss Russo, accidentally knocking me over as you rushed to set fire to Snape at that Quidditch match. You broke my eye contact. Another few seconds and I'd have got you off that broom. I'd have managed it before then if Snape hadn't been muttering a counter curse, trying to save you, Quirrell bitterly spat. Oops, Alex shrugged. Well, he still deserved I. Wait, what? The greasy bat was trying to save V? She snapped in disbelief. I knew it. Despite his hatred toward James, Venus is my daughter. He would never kill her. Lily smiled fondly. Klaus looked unimpressed, doesn't give him a leeway to harass her constantly due to a childhood rivalry. Of course, Quirrell said coolly. Why do you think he wanted to referee your next match? He was trying to make sure I didn't do it again. Funny really, he needn't have bothered. I couldn't do anything with Dumbledore watching. He suddenly snapped his fingers. Ropes sprang out of thin air and wrapped themselves tightly around Venus, Alex, and Neville. Hey! Untie us, you creep! Alex yelled, struggling out of the tight ropes. Quirrell sneered in response, his eyes glaring hatefully at an enraged Venus. You're too nosy to live, Potter. You and your loyal sidekicks. Hey! Venus abruptly snapped, interjecting what looked to be a sniveling speech. You wanna talk about sidekicks? The only pathetic sidekick I see here is you. You who used to teach Mull studies before your sabbatical, and is now sucking up to Voldemort like a pathetic rat. Although the tension in the room was stifled, the 10 supernaturals managed to crack a smile in response to Venus' heated words, while Lily bemoaned her daughter's lack of mouth filter. Rebecca chuckled nervously, doesn't know when to keep her mouth shut, just like Cole. Cole puffed up in pride, his eyes twinkling slightly when he noticed a small fond smile break out on Klaus' stoic face. The 10 supernaturals and Lily apprehensively watched the gruesome scene playing out, listening to Quirrell's grating speech as he boastfully admitted to letting the troll in, before lamenting Snape's interjection which ended with the three-headed dog nearly biting his leg off. Disregarding the troubles threesome struggling with the ropes, Quirrell began muttering under his breath while staring greedily at the mirror of Erised. Finally, he cursed, "I don't understand, is the stone inside the mirror? Should I break it?" "Oh yeah. Knock yourself out," Alex drawled, knowing that he would ruin any chances of getting the stone if he did. "Smart girl," Lily muttered. Upon noticing the 10 supernaturals staring at her with confusion, she clarified, knowing Dumbledore and his ingenious mind, he probably cast an intricate spell on the mirror. "I'm guessing if Quirrell breaks the mirror, he would never get his hands on the stone. What does this mirror do? How does it work? Help me, master." And to the troubles threesome's horror, a cold voice answered which seemed to come from Quirrell himself. "Use the girl, use Potter." Lily began trembling at the familiar voice, repeating words of denial under her breath. They all watched as Quirrell unbound the ropes from Venus and dragged her over to the mirror. "That voice. It sounds vaguely familiar," Jeremy muttered, knowing that the vampires would hear him easily with their uncanny hearing. "Lie. Lie to him," Bonnie cried out once they all got over the shock of the sorcerer's stone appearing in her pocket. "I see myself shaking hands with Dumbledore," Venus invented coolly, "Gryffindor won the house cup." Quirrell waved her away with another curse, and just as Venus was taking her wand out, a high cold voice spoke up again, "She lies, she lies." "Potter, come back here," Quirrell shouted. "Tell me the truth. What did you just see?" Venus sneered at him in return, "Your head rolling on the floor. Go to hell. I'm not telling you anything." The 11 spectators watched in morbid fascination as Quirrell began untangling his turban. Where there should have been a back to Quirrell's head, there was a face, the most terrible face they had ever seen, even the originals who lived for over a millennium. It was chalk white with glaring red eyes and slits for nostrils, like a snake. "Bloody hell," Rebecca shrieked, "Voldemort. What the hell happened to his face?" "You mean to tell me that bastard Dark Lord has been around Venus all bloody year long?" Klaus roared with unimaginable fury. Alex managed to grab her wand and used a slicing hex to cut off hers and Neville's ropes before standing loyally on either side of Venus, all three of their eyes widening in disgust, fear and horror. "Venus Potter," the ghastly head whispered, "see what I have become? Mere shadow and vapor. I have form only when I can share another's body, but there have always been those willing to let me into their hearts and minds. Unicorn blood has strengthened me. These past weeks, you saw faithful Quirrell drinking it for me in the forest, and once I have the elixir of life, I will be able to create a body of my own. Now, why don't you give me that stone in your pocket?" "How the fuck did he know?" Damon snarled. Alex and Neville began inching Venus away in slow steps, but Voldemort snarled, "Don't be a fool. Better save your own life and those of your friends and join me, or you'll meet the same end as your parents. They died begging me for mercy." "Liar." Lily screamed in apoplectic rage. The 10 supernaturals growled lowly in their throats. They had the misfortune of watching James and Lily Potter's last moments, and they were brave to the very end. Lily may have begged, but she was begging for her daughter's life and not her own. She sacrificed her life for that of her child. "Liar," Venus screamed. She was blinded by fury, and without thinking, the honey blonde witch pounced on Quirrell, her hands snaking around his neck. Quirrell let out a pained yell filled with agony as his skin began blistering upon skin contact. Bewildered at the turn of events, Venus stared at her hands with wide eyes. "What just happened?" Elijah spoke up in a hushed tone. Lily was only able to mutter two words in awe, "My protection." "Kill her," Voldemort screeched, "kill her and be done with it." Just as Quirrell aimed his wand at Venus, Neville kicked his legs, causing Quirrell to collapse onto the ground. Venus' scar was burning and she could barely see anything in front of her. Blindly, she reached out for Quirrell's hand, burning it into ash. Quirrell's screams of agony were ignored as Alex whipped out her wand, aimed it at Voldemort's face and bellowed, "Reducto!" doling out the killing blow. The Troubles threesome stared wide-eyed, jaws agape as Quirrell's face blew up, chunks of flesh and brain matter raining over them, and his decapitated form slumped onto the ground, a torrent of blood oozing out from the stump of his neck. "Damn, I really should get over my addiction of blowing up things," Alex grimaced, her nose winkling in disgust at the decapitated corpse. But before Venus could get a word in, a black cloud of vapor let out an anguished yell and soared through her body, emitting a yell of pain, and she collapsed onto the ground unconscious. Dumbledore rushed in at that moment. "Venus, Venus. Miss Russo, Mr. Longbottom, what happened?" The 10 supernaturals and Lily hadn't been able to utter a word during the whole scene, astonished that Alex Russo killed Quirrell Mort. Lily began weeping over her daughter's fate as the scene forwarded 3 days into the future, where Venus was still unconscious in the hospital wing. "It's a good thing Venus didn't kill him, otherwise she would now be a werewolf. She's too young to go through the painful transformation," Klaus whispered, his voice filled with emotion, and the Scooby gang could have sworn that the original hybrid's blue-green eyes were watering slightly. "There's no escaping her nature, Niklaus. In time, Venus will become a werewolf, especially with her living in a magical world full of hardships," Elijah grimly informed him. Caroline squealed happily in contrast to the grave ambience. "Look, Venus is waking up." Venus blinked at the pile of sweets surrounding her bed. A chuckling voice snapped her out of her reverie. "Tokens from your friends and admirers," said the beaming Dumbledore. "What happened down in the dungeons between you, Miss Russo, Mr. Longbottom and Professor Quirrell is a complete secret, so naturally, the whole school knows. I believe your friends Misters Fred and George Weasley were responsible for trying to send you a toilet seat. No doubt they thought it would amuse you. Madame Pomfrey, however, felt it might not be very hygienic, and confiscated it." "I love those twins," Cole smirked, jumping giddily. Venus pouted adorably. "Ugh, it would have been awesome. Madame Pomfrey has no sense of humor, headmaster." Dumbledore chuckled in response, his eyes twinkling. "Too right you are, Venus. She takes her job too seriously." "What happened to the stone?" she inquired curiously. Dumbledore sighed forlornly. "I see you are not to be distracted, but what you did, although you and your friends were brave, was dangerous. I feared I might be too late." "You nearly were. If it weren't for Alex's obsession with blowing up things, then the stone." "Not the stone, child, you. The effort involved nearly killed you. For one terrible moment, there, I was afraid it had. As for the stone, it has been destroyed." "At least somebody has their priorities straightened out," Klaus growled. "How could she be so nonchalant over her life? This girl would be the end of him, so careless with her life. She would be a great weakness in regards to him." "Foolish Gryffindor bravery," Lily muttered with a sob. They all listened curiously to the conversation that revolved currently around Nicholas Flamel and his wife before Venus asked a question of importance. "Sir, Voldemort's going to try other ways of coming back, isn't he? I mean, he hasn't gone, has he?"
"No, Venus, he has not. He is still out for somewhere. Perhaps looking for another body to share. Not being truly alive, he cannot be killed. He left Quirrell to die, he shows just as little mercy to his followers as his enemies. Nevertheless, Venus, while you and your friends may only have delayed his return to power, it will merely take someone else who is prepared to fight what seems a losing battle next time, and if he is delayed again, and again, why, he may never return to power."
"Somehow I doubt that," Elena commented mournfully. Lily nodded forlornly. "You are correct, Elena. Voldemort will never give up.
He longs to reign over the magical and mull world. Well then, we'll just have to rip out his heart every time he tries, Cole snarled, every word oozing with venom. Voldemort said that he only killed my mother because she tried to stop him from killing me. But why would he want to kill me in the first place? Venus asked. Something about a prophecy that I know nothing about, Klaus growled. Lily sighed and sheepishly shook her head. You're not ready to discover the prophecy yet, Nick. One day, soon. Dumbledore sighed deeply. Alas, the first thing you ask me, I cannot tell you. Not today. Not now. You will know, one day, put it from your mind for now, Venus. When you are older, I know you hate to hear this, when you are ready, you will know. And although Venus was disgruntled with the response, she grudgingly nodded her head. Good. She's too young to have the words of the prophecy hanging over her head, Lily mumbled sadly, wiping a few stray tears from her face. The 10 supernaturals were unable to ask Lily for an explanation as Venus asked the mind-boggling question of why Quirrell couldn't touch her. Your mother died to save you. If there is one thing Voldemort cannot understand, it is love. He didn't realize that love as powerful as your mother's love for you leaves its own mark. Not a scar, no visible sign, to have been loved so deeply, even though the person who loved us is gone, will give us some protection forever. It is in your skin. Quirrell, full of hatred, greed, and ambition, sharing his soul with Voldemort, could not touch you for this reason. It was agony to touch a person marked by something so good. Venus looked away, subtly wiping the tears that fell with Dumbledore's speech, her eyes longing for her mother. Tears streamed down Rebecca, Elena, Bonnie and Caroline's face toward the end of Dumbledore's heartwarming speech. You're a supermom, Lily. I think you win the Mother of the Century Award, Caroline chuckled wetly. Lily smiled and squeezed the blonde vampire's hand, thank you. Klaus glared at the opposite wall, not wanting to see those tears on Venus' face. He is her father. He should have been there to protect her. Venus is an orphan. Her life was constantly in danger, and her relatives constantly abuse her. Long ago, back when he was human, Klaus vowed that he would never allow his children to live a life like his. He failed in keeping his word. The mood lifted up slightly once Venus asked about the invisibility cloak, and the headmaster confided that it was left to him by James Potter. And there was something else. Fire away. Quirrell said Snape. Professor Snape, Venus. Venus rolled her eyes. Yeah, him. Her words were a mood lifter as the 10 supernaturals and Lily burst out into laughter. Yeah him, priceless, Cole grinned, his smile threatening to split his face in two. Quirrell said he hates me because he hated my father. Is that true? Because if it is, then that's really immature of him. Yeesh, he shouldn't take his anger out on me. Dumbledore's eyes twinkled in amusement. Well, they did rather detest each other, not unlike yourself and Mr. Malfoy. And then, your father did something Snape could never forgive. What? He saved his life. What? What? The 10 supernaturals intoned in shock, each of them whipping around to stare inquisitively at Lily, who nodded. It's true. It happened when we were 16. That's a story for another day. Yes, said Dumbledore dreamily. Funny, the way people's mind works, isn't it? Professor Snape couldn't bear being in your father's debt. I do believe he worked so hard to protect you this year because he felt that would make him and your father even. Then he could go back to hating your father's memory in peace. And sir, there's one more thing. Just the one? Venus grinned cheekily at the headmaster. How did I get the stone out of the mirror? Yes, I am curious to know the answer myself, Elijah muttered, his mahogany orbs concentrating on Dumbledore's next words. Now, I'm glad you asked me that. It was one of my more brilliant ideas, and between you and me, that's saying something. You see, only one who wanted to find the stone, find it, but not use it, would be able to get it. Otherwise they just see themselves making gold or drinking the elixir of life. My brain surprises me sometimes. Dash. Brilliant, Elijah gasped in awe. Yes, Albus is one of the most ingenious wizards in a century, Lily smiled fondly, his mind works wonders. Why do you think Dumbledore is the only person Voldemort ever feared? The scenes played forward until finally, the Troubles threesome disembarked the Hogwarts Express back to Mull London, but not before Hagrid bequeathed Venus with a photo album of her parents, drawing out smiles from everyone and a bitter one from Klaus. Suddenly, Lily sighed sadly, her emerald orbs concentrating on someone they could not see. It's time for me to leave. You'll be having another guide in my place, she walked over to Klaus' side and held his hands. Open up your heart, Nick. Don't be afraid. As you can see, love is a powerful emotion, one that would do wonders. After all, my love saved our daughter's life. Don't give up hope, she then looked at the three other originals, don't give up on each other. My daughter will need to have a united front, and loving relatives. And with one last smile to everyone, she disappeared from their midst into thin air.